You can do better than that. Good morning. Thank you, Eden. Good morning. Welcome to worship at Highland. I'm Abby Calhoun. I have the joy and the privilege of getting to lead here every week, and so I'm thankful to see you here. And I want to invite you to please stand as we begin and sing No Other Name But the Name of Jesus.
Coming up here like that. In all seriousness, it is truly a pleasure to be able to join with you today to worship. And as y'all are well aware, we have already begun that, right? We have already been led to the altar of the throne, and so excited to be able to continue to worship with you. If I don't know you, my name is Clint, and I'm the student pastor here at Highland. And on behalf of the staff, we are truly humbled and grateful that you are here to worship today. If this is your first time, or if you're a guest and have never done so, at the end of the service, there is a tent right outside of the foyer. Would love to meet you. Brother David will be there to give you a gift, to shake your hand. I feel like we're beyond COVID. We can actually do handshakes and fist bumps and all that, and just would love to give you a little more personal welcome and thank you for coming. If you are guests with us today, there's one of two things I would love for you to do for me today. One of them is, you can see a number on the screen behind me. If you text the letters HBC to that number, What's going to happen is you're going to be sent a link, and if you click on that link, you'll be sent to a very brief questionnaire, basically just a way for us to be able to meet you. A little contact information for you will be sent directly to me, and I'll reach out to you at some point this week, not to be bothersome, but just to say thank you for coming and see if there's any way that we can connect you to some particular ministries here at Highland. If you say, Clint, I'm old school, I'm not going to break my phone out in church. My parents told me that's a sin. You know what? We got you covered too. You should have been handed a worship guide as you came in, and there is a part of that that you can tear off. And if you would tear that off, fill it out and drop it in the offering box on your way out of the service this morning. There are some boxes in the foyer that also will land on my desk at some point this week. And again, I would love to connect with you. Again, welcome. We are excited that you're here. And if you'd allow me to do so, I'm going to pray over us before we continue on with our time of worship. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for allowing us to be here this morning. We thank you for the fact that you are worthy, that there is no other name to be praised, to be lifted high than the name of Jesus. That there is nothing that we can encounter on this earth that even begins to compare to how good you are. And Lord, we thank you for the fact that in all of your sovereignty and all of your power, you have still chosen to love us unconditionally. And because of that reason and so many more, we will be praising your name today. Lord, I pray not that you need our invitation, Lord, but we invite you. You invite your spirit into this place today. Lord, we love you, and it's your name that we pray. Amen.
Hey guys, happy Sunday. You guys have heard a fantastic Sunday so far. If you don't know who I am, my name is Miss Lily, and I'm the Children's Director here at Highland Baptist Church. And today, I'm going to read Exodus chapter 14, verse 14. It says this, "The Lord will fight for you. You must only need to be still." Let me read that again. "The Lord will fight for you, and you must only need to be still." Okay, so sometimes things happen in life that are really hard to deal with. Sometimes things happen in life that make us really discouraged. What are some things that have happened in your life that is hard for you to deal with or that have discouraged you? Have you maybe failed a test or accidentally been mean to a friend or missed the winning goal for a soccer game or a basketball game or any other type of sport that you play? Have you ever had a friend move away? Have you ever lost a pet? Has your favorite pet ever passed away? So many things have happened in all of our lives that discourages us and makes us sad. But God reminds us in his word, in his Bible, that he will always fight for us, that he will always, always fight for us. He loves us so much, and he knows that things will be hard sometimes. But God wants us to remember that he will always be there for us. He is always on our side, and he will always fight for us. We just need to turn to him and trust him and ask him to help us in any situation that we're going through, okay? So whenever next time y'all go through something that discourages you or makes you sad, I want you to remember that God is always with you, and he will always, always fight for you, okay? So let me pray for us. God, I thank you so much for today. I thank you for all that you bless us with. God, I thank you for tough situations that happen in our lives. God, sometimes those tough situations are hard to deal with, but God, it also shows us that you are always there and you were always fighting for us and that you will always be there for us. God, I pray that next time we go through something that is difficult to deal with, that we just remember that you were always on our side. God, I pray that you be with us as we go throughout the rest of this day, and I pray that we glorify you in all that we do. In your name I pray. Amen.
I can't think of a better song to follow that children's message than "He Knows My Name. He Knows My Every Heart. He Sees My Every Thought. He Sees Each Tear That Falls and Hears Me When I Call." And aren't we glad that we serve a God that does that? Would you stand as we continue to worship this morning?
cares of life are just too much, and I have to drink a bitter cup when I come to you with desperate cries. But it's only silence that replies. When the wilderness becomes your plan, this night will never end, and the darkness is my only friend.
Still I will praise you, still I will praise you, still my trust in you remains.
Go ahead and turn with me to 1 Kings chapter 19. That's 1 Kings chapter 19. And this morning I want to talk with you about discouragement and overcoming discouragement. Did you know that pastors get discouraged too? Everybody gets discouraged. All of us do. In fact, there was a sweet little lady dropped off a book in my office, and I've been reading through it at my leisure, and it's a little book from the 60s, and it's a little cartoon book called Brother Blotz, and it's got these little cartoons just on each little page and kind of a caption with that cartoon. And one of those cartoons is Brother Blotz, who is the pastor of this church, and it shows him, I guess he's at the dinner table eating lunch or wanting to eat lunch, and he's got this just really discouraged look on his face. And his wife is sort of standing over him, chastising him, and she's holding a ham in one hand and talking to him as he's sitting there with this discouraged look. And she says to him, as he has this discouraged look, he says, you know, and you begin with, I don't need to remind you of all this. And then you reminded of us until 12:15. Now, number one, pastors do get discouraged. Number two, that is not a true story in my family. So that was just a cartoon. But pastors get discouraged. All of us get discouraged. Every single person in here. I promise you, there are people in here right now that you are discouraged right now. You may have come in and you were not discouraged, and now you are discouraged for whatever reason. Things happen. Discouragement is real. You know, it may not seem like a big deal, but discouragement is a big deal. In fact, historian Arthur Pope, he writes this about discouragement and kind of what happens, but he uses it in the form of morale. But he says, he writes, morale wins wars. Morale wins wars. And if we look in history, one of the greatest military generals of history was a general named Hannibal. And he was the Carthaginian general, and he was known for his morale-boosting tactics. He was the guy, by the way, who marched a herd of war elephants over the Swiss Alps. Now, if that doesn't boost morale, I don't know what does. He had a saying. He had all kinds of sayings. If in his day, if there was Twitter, man, this dude would be tweeted all the time. He'd be in all kinds of different memes. One of those memes, those early memes, he says, I will find a way or I will make it. That'll boost some morale, right? But he was not just an expert at boosting his soldiers' morale. He was also an expert at lowering the morale of his enemies. He would do all kinds of things to lower that morale. He understood that morale wins wars, that discouragement leads to defeat. The team that gets discouraged is the team that will eventually succumb to it if it continues. And so in this, the same way, whether it's sports and the momentum change of a game, or whether it is in the military campaign, whatever it is, discouragement, in the same way God's team, if we're not careful, we, number one, are not immune to discouragement. And if we're not careful, it will lead to our being pulled out of ministry instead of pressing into ministry. And so in our text today, it's a fascinating text. It really is. I've never preached this text before. This is where we are in our gospel trek through the Bible. But in our text today, we're looking at one of God's generals, and he is in discouragement. His name is Elijah. He's one of the greatest figures in the Old Testament. I mean, this guy, he prayed for a drought, and it did not rain for 3.5 years. He prayed that it would rain, and it did rain. This guy raised a little child back to life. He took on 400 prophets of Baal. That was a false religion with false prophets that King Ahab and his wife Jezebel had set up. He took on 400 of those prophets, and he won. Here's how he won. He says, let's have a duel. Let's have a contest. We'll see which God is the actual real God and the greater God. And so He sent out the invitation for all Israel. They all came to Mount Carmel, and he begins to say, okay, 400 prophets of Baal, you call on your God. Here's an altar with wood and all that. You call on your God, and let's see if he answers. So from sun up to sundown, they didn't. They did all kinds of things for their God Baal to answer. And so Elijah's sort of sitting off to the side. I mean, this is the kind of guy. That's why I'm setting him up like this. He's the guy off to the side, and he's just poking fun at him. He's just making fun of him. Hey, where's your God? It's like 3 p.m. and y'all are still going at it. I mean, maybe he's on a journey somewhere. I know what it is. Maybe he's gone to the bathroom and he just hadn't come back yet. It really does say that in the Bible, by the way. I didn't make that up. He's over there taunting them. And then Elijah says, watch out, guys. Let me do this. So he says, okay, pour buckets of water onto the fire or onto the altar, and then dig a trench and then fill that with water too. And he steps up and he prays, oh Lord God, would you show yourself as real? And God rains down fire, and it burns up every bit of the altar, and it burns up even the water and the dirt on there, exposing rock. This is that guy. But yet you flip the page and it's a different guy. He's dealing with discouragement. The point that we're going to look at here is that Elijah, who also appears in the New Testament, if Elijah was this great prophet of God, but even after that God-sized victory that he won on Mount Carmel against those prophets, if he experienced discouragement, if others in the Bible experienced discouragement, guess what is true for you and me? We will experience discouragement. Individually, we will face discouraging comments and situations. Corporately, we're going to deal with discouragement. But see, God doesn't want discouragement to sideline us from ministry. In fact, he wants us to be ministered to in that moment so that we can get back into the ministry, into the mission. So what we're going to do is we're going to walk through verses 1 through 18. And we're going to show, I want to show you four highlighted truths through here of what God did in Elijah's life and what God wants to do in our life. And so the very first thing that we need to remember, the very first truth that we have to remember when dealing with discouragement is that we need to be prepared for conflict. We need to be prepared for conflict. Look with me in the first three verses. Follow along there. Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so may the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by this time tomorrow. Then he was afraid and he rose and he ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. So again, in chapter 18, Elijah took on these prophets. He saw God do this miraculous work through him, and you flip the page and it's like a different guy now. Now it's not the prophets of Baal and Elijah, now it's Jezebel and Elijah. Jezebel was the wife of King Ahab, and King Ahab was really primarily a figurehead because the person who really wore the pants in the kingdom was Jezebel. She was a mean, evil snake of a woman. She was mean. So mean that, just put this into context. You just saw God do this miraculous work just the day before, and now you're running for your life at this one lady's threat. If we're honest, we'd probably do the same thing. We do it in all kinds of different areas of our life. God gives us some victory in our life, and then the next moment, our eyes are off the victory and onto, oh man, somebody said this. Or, oh man, something happened here. And what if I did something wrong? Or what if I can't get this done? What if I fail at this next part? But we just saw God do this. And yet our eyes, just like Elijah, goes from God to us in the blink of an eye. And so what happens here is that she threatens his life, and he goes from the north of Israel all the way to the most southern part of Israel that he can find. By the way, when we went through Jonah, there's a lot of similarities here. Remember Jonah running like 1,000 miles in the opposite direction? Well, we see this happening with Elijah here. He's not really trying to get away from God. He's trying to get away from Jezebel. So he goes to Beersheba, the most southern part of Israel that he can get to, down in southern Judah. And so he's down there, and he's kind of just maybe just hanging out by himself, maybe trying to figure out what he's going to do. But nevertheless, there's this fear that has overwhelmed him, that has led to him in that area or into that direction. You know, over the past 20 years of or more now in ministry, you learn a lot about ministry, people, and the enemy. And one of the things that you can absolutely count on is that when you serve the Lord, the enemy will attack. When you serve the Lord, the enemy will attack. When you decide, I'm going to be on God's team, and I'm going to start doing what God says do, we're going to start reaching our neighborhood, we're going to do the block party, we're going to do the basketball camp, we're going to do all these things, I promise you, when you push against the darkness will push back. It will happen. We have to be prepared for conflict, but not all conflict is bad. Some of it is, but not all conflict is bad. And so we have to be prepared for conflict. We have to be prepared for when the enemy gives us that word of discouragement. If we're going to stay in the fight, then we have to remember that serving the Lord brings conflict. It may come through fatigue. It may come through a discouraging comment, even from well-meaning people. It may come through fear or a lack of faith. But serving Jesus brings conflict. In fact, it's one of Satan's most used tools. I want you to think about for just a moment all the things that you've seen and experienced in church, whether you are 5 or whether you are 85. How many times have you seen horrible moral failure in church? Maybe once, maybe twice, but probably not more than that. How many times have you just heard somebody stand up and start just cussing everybody out in church? I've only heard that once. I'm not kidding. Actually, we're cussing us out. They were cussing God out. But I've been in ministry more than 20 years. And that's the only time I've ever heard that. Now think about how many times you've been discouraged in church. How many times has the church body been discouraged about something? Probably way more than you like to count. It is Satan's most used and useful tool is discouragement. It's a word, it's a comment, it's a thought, it's a feeling. And we get locked on that feeling. And if we're not careful, that comment or whatever it is, that pushing back from the darkness, our eyes will be constantly focused on that. And we turn them from Jesus down to ourself. And we begin to pull away from ministry instead of pressing us closer into ministry. It happens all the time. Every time we see a win, I can promise you there's going to be a discouragement right around the corner that's going to threaten to pull us out of that. Be prepared for conflict. Second truth here, don't neglect your physical health. Don't neglect your physical health. When you're discouraged, overcoming discouragement, don't neglect your physical health. Look at verses 4-8 with me. It says, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree. And he asked that he might die, saying, it is enough now, O Lord. Take away my life, for I am no better than my fathers. And he lay down and slept under a broom tree. And behold, an angel touched him and said to him, arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was at his head a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. And he ate and drank and lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you. And he arose and ate and drank and went in his strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Mount Horeb, the Mount of God. So here the story continues that Elijah went a day's journey. He's down in Beersheba. He goes even further into the wilderness. He may be running away from Jezebel to figure out what to do next, maybe. Maybe he just wants to hide where no one can find him, be the last place that people would go looking for him. But as he sat down, he prayed that God would take his life. Again, sounds a little bit like Jonah, right? Jonah was running from ministry, and guess what we see Elijah? He's running from ministry. We cannot run from what God has called us to do. You can try, but God is going to come after you, right? He's going to keep pursuing. He's going to keep seeking you out. He wants us back into the game. And so here, he sits down and he prays that God would take his life. And basically what the idea here is that Elijah, he's had enough. He just wants out. He's spent. He's done. I didn't sign up for this, God. I mean, I'm done. Think about it. We just saw Elijah overcome, or God through Elijah, take down the 400 prophets of Baal. Elijah in his mind, and ours too, would be thinking, okay, battle won, let's go on and have a wonderful time. But someone even more evil pops up in the next flip of the page. Surely he's got to be thinking, God, what is the point? If I only see one battle, then the next thing I might have to do it all over again? Why, God? Why? Can't you take care of this stuff? See, I believe that every discouragement, no matter what it is ultimately a spiritual discouragement. Because in its essence, what we're saying is, God, you either don't know what's going on, you either don't care what's going on, or you either don't have enough power to deal with what's going on. So why are you not working, God? Why do I take one step forward and two steps back, God? Why can't it be easier, Lord? Really, it's a question of God's sovereignty. For Elijah, we'll see in just a second, he looks so inward. He's like, God, I'm the only one doing everything that you've called me to do. Nobody else is doing it. Why do I need to keep doing this, God? Because obviously it's not working. And really what he's saying is, God, you're not working. You're not doing what I think you need to do. And in our discouragement, we can often say the same kinds of things. So in this, what does God do? He comes for Elijah. He doesn't chastise him. He doesn't, you know, do anything other than he gives him some much needed rest and energy. I want you to see this and how important this is. He comes to him, and by the way, this is not prescriptive in Scripture. This is descriptive, but nevertheless, it's in here. Is that when we're discouraged to this point, sometimes we just need some rest. Sometimes we just need some rest from the busyness and the hurriedness. So God gave Elijah some needed rest. We don't know how long he slept, but he did rest under the broom tree, it says. And so sometimes we just need to, if we find ourselves exhausted in ministry and following the Lord, and we're discouraged, sometimes we just need to rest. So the question is, are you resting well? See, resting is really a cause of, are you trusting in God's sovereignty or not? When we trust in God's sovereignty, we can rest. When we don't, and worry and anxiety and fear and all these other things take over, then we're not really trusting in God's sovereignty anymore. Think about when Jesus was on the Sea of Galilee with those fishermen, right? These are expert fishermen, professional fishermen. The storm comes on to them. They literally are terrified. They think they're going to die. And where do we find Jesus? In the back of the boat asleep. And they're wondering, do you not care about us? And Jesus is like, well, of course I care about you. When? Stop. It was an issue with their sovereignty. Is God in control or is he not in control? Is he worth continuing the fight with, or is he not worth continuing the fight with? So sometimes we just need to rest, just like Elijah. Also, we need to make sure we're eating and drinking, right? God woke Elijah up so he could refresh him physically. God knew this journey was going to be difficult, and that Elijah was going to be sent on this journey, so he needed his strength. I don't know how God did it, but God had some food right there cooked at his head. But he gave Elijah what he needed. God has designed our bodies to need food and water and drink, right? Because God has designed us that way, that's not a bad thing. That's a perfect thing. God has given us these things to give us the needed energy that we have. And oftentimes, discouragement, depression, and all those things, it will cause people not to want to eat, not to want to get plenty of fluids. But something as simple as food and water can do an amazing thing just in your mind. And so sometimes we need rest. Sometimes in our discouragement, we need to just make sure that we're doing the basic physical needs that we have, that God has given us. But more than that, God sent Elijah to go get some exercise. It doesn't really say that, but Elijah basically ran an ultra marathon. He ran nonstop for 40 days and 40 nights. Now, whether or not this verse is a miracle or not, that's besides the point. I mean, it definitely would have been a miracle for me to run 40 days and 40 nights. For some of you, it may have been just a Tuesday. I don't know. But the point here is that he's sending Elijah to a place, and he's given him the provision to get there. He ran 40 days, 40 nights to a place called Mount Horeb. Mount Horeb is Mount Sinai. They're the same place. Mount Sinai, if you remember, is the place where Moses met the Lord and received the Ten Commandments. This is where Moses would constantly meet with the Lord for those 40 days and 40 nights. Why is he doing that? I think he wants to get Elijah to the place that he needs to hear from the Lord. Elijah's not in a place where he can hear from the Lord. He's on the run. He's looking too much inwardly to himself. He just wants to hide. He wants out of ministry. He doesn't want to do the job that God's given him to do anymore. He's not in a place where he is ready to hear from the Lord. And so God gave him the provision. He gave him the direction. And he's sending him to this place where he can hear from the Lord. Exercise, a lot of times, has this way of changing our thinking. It changes, you know, just the endorphins and all those things that may be released. This has a way that God has really designed our bodies, that when we're just not as discouraged and we're a little bit more open to what God is doing in our life after we've exercised, after we've eaten, after we've gotten the kind of rest that we need. And I found personally, most of you know that I do try to exercise and things. I found personally that when I am most discouraged, that's when I am the most least likely to want to go do anything. And the same is true for you probably too. But I have to force myself. Just like I have to force myself to eat, we have to force ourselves to get rest. We need to force ourselves to do these things. Not in our own strength, but in what God is doing in us and for us. So we don't neglect our spirit, our physical health. Third, let me go through this. So we need to be prepared for conflict. We need to work. We need to look at our physical health. But even more importantly, we go to the Lord for spiritual renewal. We go to the Lord for spiritual renewal. So there's two primary places that God wants us to be in for spiritual renewal. And we see these right here. They're God's word and God's presence. So we can name them as word and worship. That's where God wants us to be. For us to be renewed, it takes God's word and it takes us being in God's presence with God's word. And we see that. Look at verse 9. The word of the Lord came to Elijah. There he came to a cave and lodged in it. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. And he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He will bring this question up again in just a few minutes. But for right now, he's asking that question. What are you doing here, Elijah? Remember, he's getting Elijah into the spot for Elijah to listen so that he can hear what God has to say. And so his first question is, what are you doing here, Elijah? But don't miss the point here is that Elijah did not come looking for the word of the Lord, did he? God's word came looking for Elijah. You know, I don't remember who said this, but it's such a good, I'll paraphrase it. But when you read the Bible, the greatest part of reading the Bible is not you reading the Bible, it's the Bible reading you. It has a way of doing that, right? Is that when we read scripture and you start seeing this like, man, how does God know all this about me? How does he know those deep parts of my heart? How does he know I think that? God's word has a way of unveiling and uncovering those parts in our life that need redemption, that need sanctification. God's word does that, and he's doing that here to Elijah. God didn't come to condemn Elijah in his discouragement. He pursued Elijah. He sought Elijah. God came to Elijah. God's word came to Jonah, remember, when he was angry with God for being merciful to the Ninevites. God's word pursued Peter after Peter had denied the Lord three times. For Elijah, God's word was, "What are you doing here?" For Jonah, it was, "Why are you angry?" For Peter is, "Do you love me?" So in your discouragement, what is God's question for you? What is God's question for you? Could it be, "What are you doing here?" Could it be, "Why are you so angry at me?" Could it be, "Do you really love me?" Those are three very good diagnostic questions that God's word pursues those who are in discouragement. And he does the same for each one of us today. God's word is, we must go to God's word for restoration, for refreshment, for renewal. In our discouragement, one of the best things that we can do is open God's word. Even if you don't know where to read, just start reading somewhere. I promise you, the Holy Spirit will then take over and direct you. But we go to God's word. But then Elijah stood in the presence of the Lord. Look at verse 10. He says, "I have been very jealous for the Lord." So God asked him a question, "What are you doing here?" Here's Elijah's response. "I've been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And he, that's God, said, go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, what are you doing here? Elijah began, his response was a very me-centered view of his life in ministry. And discouragement can often do the same for us. It makes us think that we're the only ones in the fight, that we're the only ones doing what's right and what it takes, what God wants us to do. We're the only ones that really cares, God. But God doesn't respond to Elijah's frustration right away, does he? He tells Elijah, he gives him a command. He says, stand before the Lord. Sometimes we just need to be in the Lord's presence to get our eyes off ourselves. Amen? Sometimes the most needed place to be, even when you're the most discouraged, is with God's people in worship. Just to stand before the Lord. And so then the Lord has Elijah in this place to hear him, and he uses three catastrophic scenes: a strong wind, an earthquake, a raging fire. But the Lord was not in those things. Then there came this low and gentle whisper. And Elijah, I can't imagine, he just leaned in, and the Lord had his attention. He asked, what are you doing here, Elijah? You know, God does speak through miracles. God does speak through the big victories that we as a church and as individual Christians have. But that's not the only way God speaks. Sometimes God speaks through the small, the seemingly insignificant, sometimes the mundane activities of life. Those low whispers that are around us. Sometimes that's what makes us lean in his word and in worship to be renewed. I want to show you the last part real quick. We have to be prepared. We look at our physical health. We go for spiritual renewal. But none of that really matters if we don't get back in the fight. If we don't get back onto the field. If we don't continue on, none of that other stuff matters. Look at the last part, 14 through 18. He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Look, he's given the same thing. I think this is important, is that even after God has him in the spot to teach him something, Elijah repeats that same egocentric understanding. Look, just because we do the right things, like hearing from the Lord, like getting into his presence, doesn't mean that we immediately understand and get it right. It's not always a switch that flips. Sometimes it's a process, a progression that the Lord has taken us through, what we see here. And so then he goes on, and the Lord said to him in verse 15, go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. So God gives him a command, doesn't chastise him, doesn't ridicule him, doesn't wonder, why do you keep saying this? He gives him a command, he gives him a mission, a commission even. Go back north, go back to Damascus, and then he gives him three things to do. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. That's first. And then second, Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be king over Israel. I'm sorry, Syria and then Israel. And then the third thing, Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abimaholah, and you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death. And the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal and every mouth that has not kissed him. So he gives him three things to do. Command, go do these things. Here are your three things to do. Anoint as king, anoint as prophet. And I love the application that we see here is that in your greatest discouragement, God ministers to his ministers. God ministers to his ministers. And it's not just those in vocational ministry, because all of us, Paul says, are given the ministry of reconciliation, that if you are part of the family of God, then you are a minister of God, that you have been given the ministry of bringing other people to Jesus. And so many times discouragement keeps us from the fight, keeps us out of that ministry. But we're called to that ministry. We cannot run from that ministry. God doesn't chastise us and ridicule us in the discouragement, but he ministers to those who minister so that we can get back in the fight, so that we can get back to the ministry of reconciliation. I mean, think about it. I mean, God says, look, these are the things that you do. And oh yeah, Elijah, I know that you think you're alone, but you are not alone. I've left 7,000 people in Israel that are not worshiping the Baal, that are sold out to me, that are doing the same thing that you are doing. Man, you just look around our culture, and ministry in our culture makes us feel alone, doesn't it? We wonder, am I the only one seeing this? What is happening in our culture? But God's saying, you're not alone. I'm there with you. I've got other people in the fight with you. Look, seriously, if the enemy, if he sidelines us through discouragement, what hope do people have to hear the gospel? What hope do people have that are around you to hear the gospel if the enemy sidelines you through discouragement? If people are going to go to hell, let it be because they have to step over our bodies, not because we're decided we're done with it. Get back in the fight. If you see someone else out of the fight, encourage them. Walk alongside them. Help them get back into the fight. I want to close with one of the most famous speeches of the 20th century. It was given at the Harrow School by the great statesman Winston Churchill, Prime Minister of England, on October 29th, 1941. I'm not giving you the whole speech. In fact, it's not really long. It was one of his shorter speeches he gave. He had been invited to speak to the school, but couldn't for about a year. And so finally, when the day arrived, the student body, the faculty, they were so excited about hearing from the great statesman Winston Churchill. They couldn't wait to hear what he was going to say. But his speech only lasted 4 minutes and 12 seconds. Here were his closing remarks. Never give in. Never give in. Never, 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 in nothing, great or small, large or petty, never give in. Except to convictions of honor and good sense. Never yield to force. Never yield to the apparently overwhelming might of the enemy. And his last concluding words was, we can be sure that we only have to persevere to conquer. We have only begun to do the work that God's called us to do as Hylam. And we're doing it. We're seeing win after win after win. The block party was awesome. The random acts of kindness this past week was great. We've got the basketball camp tomorrow. All of those things are heading in the right direction. But that is only the beginning. As we push into the darkness will push back. It may come through dangerous means. It may come through all those means. But I can promise you it will come through discouragement. We will have to battle discouragement, which is why I believe the Lord has this word for us this morning. What are we going to do when we see those in our congregation get discouraged? How do we battle spiritual discouragement? We battle it with gospel encouragement. You see, Jesus went to the cross for every single one of us. And if you don't think Jesus was discouraged, then you haven't read his high priestly prayer or the Garden of Gethsemane scene. Jesus was discouraged. He did not want to take on the cross. He wanted anything but that. He asked his father any other way, but the father said no. And so Jesus says, well, not my will, but yours. So he submitted to that. So even in his discouragement, God the Father was right there with him. Even when he went to the cross, God the Father was right there with him. And Jesus died for every discouraging feeling, word, or everything else discouraging that happens in our life. Jesus took that to the cross. And when he rose 3 days later, he became king over all of our discouragement. And now we live lives that are resurrected to encouragement. So when you see people in this church dealing with discouragement in all of its different forms, help them get back to Jesus. Help them hear from Jesus. Stay in the fight. The souls of every girl, boy, man, and woman that are around this church and in your life, Jesus wants them. He's called us to this ministry of reconciliation. May we continue on in that ministry, because we never give up, we never give in, and we can be sure that we only have to persevere to see Jesus conquer. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. We thank you. What a timely word you've given to us this morning. Father, would you magnify and multiply the effectiveness of your word in our lives? We give you this response time. If there are any in here, Lord, that need to experience salvation, Lord, would you give them that today? Would they call on you, Lord, to be saved? Father, for those who are discouraged, Lord, would you comfort? Would you come alongside them in the work of your Spirit to bring encouragement, to walk with them through this? God, and that we would look to Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him at the cross, he ran his race, and so that we may too. Father, we love you, and we thank you for what you're doing in our church. God, may you accomplish all things for your glory and for the good of this city through us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would stand with me, if there's a decision that you'd like to make, I'm going to be down front. I would love to know how to pray or lead you in a further decision. Let's respond. For being here. We are so glad that you chose to spend the morning with us. Look, if I have not been able to meet you personally, I would love that opportunity. I have a gift for you right outside out here. And then there's a little tent out there. I'd love to meet you real quick. And I don't want to hold you up from your lunch plans and all that, but I do want to meet you and hand you your gift. But I'll be right out front. Look, we have a youth parents meeting immediately following the service this morning. And also, we have our basketball camps starts tomorrow through Wednesday, 9 to 11. We still can use people to sign up for that. You can let one of the staff know, and we would love to put you on that list. Or you can just show up tomorrow at 9 a.m., and we'll go to 11 serving the Lord together. All right, that's all we have. Let me pray, and then we'll be dismissed. Father, we love you. We thank you so much for loving us first. God, as we go out these doors, would you empower us with your Spirit to do the work that you have called us to do of bringing people to Jesus. Give us the boldness, give us wisdom, give us clarity in the gospel as we point and as we speak for Jesus in this next week. Lord, we love you and we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.